welcome to today's Mono Lake Moment here at Panum Crater. You can see the beautiful Sierra Nevada mountain range behind me. Still has a little bit of snow on it. This mountain range is heavily tied to our topic today, how Panum Crater formed. But I also want to introduce you to the Mono Craters just to our south, which is a very young, the youngest mountain range in North America, a young chain of volcanic craters that formed in the last 40,000 years ago or so, the youngest of which we're standing on right now, called Panum Crater, which was formed only about 650 years ago. So you can see the jagged top of Panum Crater, and I'm standing here on the rim. So Panum Crater starts in the mountains, the formation of Panum Crater starts in the mountains, where we have snow falling in the wintertime, and then that water melts and flows down both in the tributary streams that feed into Mono Lake and in the groundwater. So it actually sinks into the soil matrix, flows over rocks and through the different soils that come down from the mountains, and flows by gravity down to the lowest point, which in this case is Mono Lake. And this groundwater is what helps form the tufa towers, because it takes calcium from the rocks as it's flowing through that groundwater matrix and then bubbles up underneath the carbonate-rich lake, and the calcium and carbonate form tufa. But before it reaches Mono Lake, in the formation of Panum Crater, that groundwater was flowing over an area where there is a magma chamber deep below the surface. So right now I'm standing above a huge cavern filled with magma. So magma is superheated rock underneath the ground. When it erupts, we call it lava. So magma underground, lava above ground. So this giant magma chamber is sitting beneath us, and it's starting to rise. Pressure is pushing that magma towards the surface. And when it gets close enough, the groundwater is flowing between it and the surface, and it heats that groundwater. So what happened here with Panum Crater is the magma pushed high enough where it heated up the water, and one molecule of H2O, one molecule of water, expands 800 times when it turns to steam. So it caused, that heating of the water caused a huge eruption. We call that the phreatic eruption, a steam eruption, where it pushed all of the soil off the top. We have a fun little demonstration of how that happens here. So if you can imagine underneath the ground here, the magma's heating, it heats up that water, and boom, all the top soil and rocks come off of the top of the ground, and this large crater is formed. You can actually see the rim here as this material is pushed outwards. And so that's the first eruption in this three-phased eruption of building Panum Crater. That eruption created a hole that taps down into the magma chamber, creates a conduit. And so that allows then the heat and the magma and the pressure and the gas to come erupting out. So the second phase of the eruption is when all that pressure is released and lava is actually spewing out of this conduit. So much pressure. If you imagine taking a soda bottle and shaking it up, you have all the gas bubbles that form foam. And when you finally release that pressure, it explodes out of the bottle. So we call that the pyroclastic flow. That's the second phase of this eruption, where it's actually spewing out lava and gas, thousands of degrees, moving really fast as it flows out of this new hole in the ground. And it actually blew out the southern end of the crater. You can actually see behind me where it dips down. It blew out and flowed down towards the lake. But then, as the pressure starts to decrease, the magma slows down as it starts to come out of the conduit of that hole. And it oozes out almost the thickness of toothpaste. So it's this very viscous, slow eruption still, but the lava's moving slowly and it cools. It cools very quickly for kind of geologic time. You think of granite, which cools over millions of years underground, and the rocks that are cooling coming from that magma are cooling, some of them instantaneously if they're small enough drops, some take a few days, but essentially this lava just keeps oozing out of the hole here and cooling and filling and filling all these holes with rock that cools and then cracks as it cools, and more lava is pushing up underneath and breaking off chunks of rock, which is why we see the top of Panum Crater that looks so broken and jagged, and there's lots of big squarish sharp boulders, because it's cooling and cracking and breaking off. So this is the dome formation where the rocks that are coming out, the lava that's coming out actually cools and plugs the hole and then continues to break apart, roll down the hill, whatnot, until it just forms this jumble of giant rocks. Big spires form. You can see some of the big spires sticking up high, that lava comes out through cracks and cools in the cracks, and then they fall off and fall to the side. But part of the, one of the most amazing parts of this particular eruption is that the rocks involved are very amazing. And these two rocks that you see here, this one is called obsidian. It's very smooth and hard and black. It's essentially, it is volcanic glass. And this rock that you see here is really light. It has all these little tiny holes and it's light gray. Now, these two rocks are chemically exactly the same. They're silica and water, and this one just has lots of gas mixed in, mostly carbon dioxide gas. So it has all these little bubbles that form and pop. Whereas this one cooled very quickly, and all of the air bubbles have been squeezed out of it as it cools. It's called the air bubbles are exsolved out of the rock. So obsidian and pumice, they're exactly the same, but they formed two different ways. This one with lots of air, and this one was so hot and cooled so quickly that no air was trapped. Now, obsidian is very useful and has been very useful in history. So the Kutsetika people who live here use obsidian in their tool making, mostly with handheld knives, but you can carve, it's called flaking obsidian, to get it to be very, very sharp. And actually some veterinarians will use obsidian instead of stainless steel for scalpels, because it can get so much sharper than metal. That also makes it very dangerous to touch, so you have to be careful and make sure that you don't have an extra sharp piece. But the Kutsetika would trade obsidian from the Mono Basin and from Panum Crater with the Native Americans in Yosemite. And so we see a lot of Mono Basin obsidian in a lot of the archaeological sites, in the museums, and of course still out in nature there, because it was traded for acorns and bear skins and manzanita berries, things that we don't have here. So obsidian is a very important trade item, and pumice also has a lot of uses. Most commonly people know it as what we use in the bath to scrub off calluses on our heels, but it's also ground up and used in certain soaps to help get the grease off your hands, a lot of like mechanic soaps. It's called lava soap because it's made out of lava. So these two rocks have a lot of uses, and they came out of this incredible eruption here at Panum Crater. Now, as I mentioned, this only happened 650 years ago. So people were living here and animals live all around here. So when this eruption happened and the ash was thrown up into the air, and as I mentioned, the hot gas flows, about a 7-mile radius, everything in a 7-mile radius was wiped out, was destroyed. It must have been a pretty scary time to be living here in the area. But we see evidence of ash from the Panum Crater eruption all the way as far as Walker Lake, which is maybe 60 miles, 50 or to 60 miles to the east, maybe a little bit more than that. And we definitely see evidence of the ash settling in Mono Lake as well. So we can tell when that eruption happened. It's a beautiful day here at Panum Crater. And there's birds singing around me, green-tailed towhees. We saw a gray flycatcher. Thank you so much for coming here and learning about Panum Crater and how it formed, seeing the beautiful views of the Sierra. And I hope you have a wonderful day.